My name is Maurice Dussault. I work in Earth Sciences, and thank you for coming. Today we're going to have a presentation by Chris Hawley, a colleague and a friend from Alberta. And he's been involved in policy for going on close to 40 years now. I think he made the decision early in his career that he wished to stay in public service and public policy. And the issue he's going to talk about today is, by the way, Chris is a physicist by training, which is an unusual creature in the public policy, but he does have a MSc in public policy as well, Master of Public Policy Studies, that's right. So he's been involved at all levels, all the way from the village level to the international level in issues having to do with the life cycle of energy, royalty issues, everything having to do with the public policy and in the energy industry in Alberta, and of course interacting with people in Ottawa and Washington, Paris and London, which is what he's been doing for the last few years. I want to put today's talk into a little bit of context. 2 days ago, if you went into the business section of the Globe and Mail, there was a banner headline there saying, I can't remember the number, $17 or $27 billion lost per year. And the Premier of Alberta, Alison Redford here, if you want to go to the Alberta website, she's going to talk to Albertans at 6:52 tonight, Alberta time, which is 8:52 Ontario time, so you can watch her on television if you wish. And here's what she's going to talk about. Right now, internationally, the price of Brent crude, which is the standard price on the east coast of Canada, is $110, more or less. The price of crude oil in the Midwest of the United States, Cushing, Oklahoma, right now is $95 a barrel. The price that Canadians are getting for their crude oil coming out of Hardisty is $55 a barrel. And the American refining industry is extremely, extremely happy with that. Now, if you do the math with the amount of oil that is shipped to the United States from Western Canada every year, this amounts to a $20 to $25 billion per year subsidy. And you might say, well, so what? Alberta's rich. Think about it. Quebecers, people in eastern Ontario and the Maritimes are paying $110 a barrel for their oil. And there's oil being sold from Alberta in the United States at $55 a barrel. Who is subsidizing the Americans? That's right, it's the Quebecers and eastern Canadians, because they're paying twice the price of oil that is being sold in the Midwest. Now, how much does it cost to build a pipeline, let's say, from, because the only way that this price can equalize is on supply and demand. So how much would it cost to build a pipeline, for example, from, let's imagine, Edmonton to the West Coast, $6 billion. My gosh, that's one quarter of that amount. For one quarter of the amount of subsidy that we are providing to the American citizens each year, a pipeline could be built to open up new markets. Now, do you think the American government wishes to change that situation? No. In fact, they will probably do everything possible, short of sending in the Marines, of course, everything possible to try to maintain that situation, because this $20 billion, $25 billion subsidy is part of what's driving the American recovery. So that's the issue that Premier Redford is going to talk about on the television tonight. And she's going to basically say to Alberta citizens, what the hell do you want to do? What can we do? And maybe she'll have some suggestions and answers. So, Chris is not going to talk inflammatory words like I'm talking, I'm sure, because he is a representative of the Alberta government. But he's going to describe to you Alberta's strategic view of the energy industry and give you a few insights. This is being recorded. After the recording is done, after the talk is done, the recording will stop, and then Chris will be available to answer questions or discussions in a more relaxed context. So I'd like to introduce you to Chris Hawley, a friend and colleague. Thank you for coming, Chris. Yeah.
Just a point of clarity, this may sound funny. How long do we have?
As long as you wish. This room is available till noon.
Okay. And the reason I state that is, well, first of all, good morning. And I really enjoy the opportunity of being here. I do on occasion go into universities like this and have a conversation. So I have a slide deck with me, but I don't have to follow it. The slide deck is there more to remind me of certain points that I want to raise. But as I'm going through and I raise items, if you've got a question or a comment, I value that feedback. And we'll manage to get through what I think are some of the key messages. And I'm going to give you the key messages up front. But I will tell you that I'm not going to talk about today's policies, discussions that are taking place. I can talk to you about current policy, but what I want to give you is a little bit of a vision of where we see strategically energy markets going. And if you get an understanding of where energy markets are going, you begin to get a sense of where you need to put your research priorities. So one of my past positions within the Department of Energy was issues manager for the executive. How many here have ever heard of the formal discipline of issues management? Are you aware there is an International Issues Management Council that actually talks about the discipline of issues management? I'm a great believer in that discipline. And my job as issues manager was no issues. That was my performance criteria. How do you ensure that no issues happen? You do some strategic thinking ahead of time. You do the research ahead of time. So you don't create an issue. I will tell you that once you've got an issue or a crisis from a public policy perspective, you have very limited options to pursue. And the options you have tend to cost a lot of money. So if you want to be effective in public policy and issues management, you work ahead of the wave. You have the widest range of options to look at, and you have the least cost involved. And one of the key tools in issues management is research. So that's my intent today, is to give you a bit of a strategic vision of where we're going. Here's the irony. I'm in Waterloo. I used to own a BlackBerry. I don't. I have iProducts. I was not able to update this presentation like I would like because iPad doesn't give me the ability. In addition, we're having problems with our security system. And I can't connect back into the server in the Department of Energy. So I have a technician on 24/7 in the Department of Energy right now that keeps synchronizing all my iProducts with Edmonton. The advice I have when I go back home tomorrow is they're giving me a BlackBerry back. I just thought I would mention this to you, okay? So, you know, so forgive me if some of the slides are outdated. But I mentioned to you they are placeholders for me essentially to have a bit of a conversation. So what am I going to talk about? What's happening is really fascinating when you look at the energy industry. Technology development is changing our markets faster than probably ever before. And that has some real implications for a nation like Canada, which tends to be a net energy exporter. We're seeing a lot of what we call energy independence happening. We're seeing what used to be global markets fragmenting into regional markets. And because of that regional market movement, we're seeing a lot of policies that I would suggest to you begin to have an impact on being able to trade energy commodities across regions, across borders. And I'll speak to you a little bit about the policies involved in that. What we're also finding is the policies that support regionalization of energy often have an environmental banner. But when you begin to dig in the detail, you tend to find out they're economic. And I'll give you examples. And some, I was talking with Steve today about the Fuel Quality Directive in Europe, the Low Carbon Fuel Standard, other things of this nature. We'll get into some discussion. So how does Canada and Alberta fit in that type of future going forward? And I'm not going to talk from a policy side, I'm going to talk to you from a research side about some of the things that we're trying to do to give us the flexibility to be able to still operate in the future. And that's the last part, the strategic directions. So I've already told you the key points. Now I want to tell you the story of how we got there. But again, as I pointed out, I really welcome the opportunity for a dialogue from you as well. So I want questions, okay? Why is this picture up there? Just to show you, number one, the type of context of the energy supply out of Alberta. But look at the changing conditions of what we are potentially producing today and potentially producing in the future. Look at the natural gas. It's decreasing. We've known about that for a long time. This does not include shale gas. This does not include tight gas. Okay? Look at the picture on oil production. Look at that amount going forward, and you see a lot of it is dealing with our viscous oils, our bitumen oils. Huge growth that's happening there. Now, this is projected. But something I want to point out to you is the amount of oil that we produced in 1973-74 in Alberta and Canada was peak oil production in Canada and Alberta till 2005-2006. So in 2005, this level approximately, this is in energy units, it's not in volume, was the same amount of energy we produced in oil in 1973. But in fact, the production, if you had the map way over here, you would see production dropped way down, and now it's building back up. The point I want to leave with you is the pipeline capacity that existed in Canada in 1973 was built in the 1960s. And from 1973 to 2005, we had surplus takeaway capacity in Canada for our oil and essentially our gas. What's happening today, just as an insight, we have not sufficient capacity. We are oversupplied in oil. We haven't got enough pipe to move oil out of the country. On the gas side, we got empty gas pipes. And the comment that I'll bring to you is that a lot of this is because of technology development. And that's what I want to spend the next few slides is going through and giving you an idea of how technology has actually changed the markets for energy products. So this is some of the current technologies that are used to produce viscous oils, the oil sands. By the way, something I like to clarify for people is that oil sands, the definition, is not a geological definition. In Alberta, it was a definition used to define a fiscal regime north of the 53rd township and gave it a different royalty treatment. And what's happened through the media, through the use and everything else, everybody thinks oil sands is a unique oil. The answer is no, it is not. We have oil deposits in the oil sands region that are lighter than some of our conventional oils produced in southern Alberta and Saskatchewan. But we called it oil sands because we wanted to have a different royalty and fiscal regime. So in Alberta, when you take a look at the royalty systems, you find there's a difference between the viscous oils or the oils above the 53rd township than below. And actually, Maurice did a study for us in 2001, 2002 on cold heavy oil production. And we actually noticed on the same field all sorts of development north of the 53rd township, none south. And you want to know why? There was a capital cost allowance if you produced north of the 53rd township that wasn't available to you if you were below. So my comment is understand some of the language. So number one, oil sands is a geographic region. It tends to be a viscous oil that's in that region. But it is not the heaviest oil in the Western Canadian Sedimentary Basin. So here's some of the technologies. And I've listed them up there because I wanted to give you an idea of some of the changes that are happening and spending a few minutes on this. Because I'm going back and I'm saying markets are changing because of technology advances. So cyclic steam stimulation is an old technology. It's the type of technology that's been used in California in the heavy oil fields and Baker fields since 1960. I know you'll often hear me refer to my father. That's my father-in-law. He used to spend time in California in the 1960s, introducing that technology into the heavy oil fields into Alberta. Steam-assisted gravity drainage. I'm going to show you some slides of what's happening with that technology and how it's actually beginning to explode, and we're seeing some phenomenal exponential growth in production out of regions that use that technology. There is cold heavy oil production with sand. That's where we're actually producing viscous oils without putting any thermal energy into the reservoir. That's changing. But we have some very new things. Solvent injection. We actually have solvent injection pilots working with cyclic steam, with steam-assisted gravity drainage, and with CHOPS. And we're getting some very interesting results. From a carbon footprint perspective, if you go primary and you don't put thermal energy down, you actually reduce the greenhouse gas emissions associated with producing that oil. It may be heavy, but you can still produce it. Polymer flooding. We're seeing new generations of polymer, 2 to 3 generations per year, being developed. Some of our recent studies are indicating that we can produce viscous oils with polymers at less than $30 life cycle cost per barrel. Again, new technology, new area. Polymers are also being applied to oil sands tailings. And Maurice and I have had some discussion about the success of that, but it is a whole new area. Very old. There were chemical floods in the 60s and 70s. But this is a whole area that's re-emerged on this. And we run about 8 pilots right now in Alberta in different oil types, different salinity of waters, trying to get an idea of how the polymers will work. Huge area of growth.
And thermally resistant polymers are being developed for application in conjunction with steam.
Absolutely. So one of the things here that I haven't got in detail, but what's also happening in our thermal production is we're improving the lift technology. Now, I'm assuming some of you are familiar with things when I'm talking about pressure lift, mechanical lift, once through steam generators, drum boilers, all these different things that are changing. We're finding technology to actually produce that oil out of the ground at a more efficient rate and less cost. So some huge changes, which I'll show you graphically in a minute.
Chris, yeah? You were talking about polymer flooding or solvent injection. Is it being used as a primary production method, or is it being used as a secondary or even tertiary?
Combination of both. We're seeing a lot of interest going back into our conventional fields and using different polymer surfactant alkali floods with success. But we actually have floods going in API oil anywhere probably from 6 to 22, 24 degree oil. And we're seeing a lot of difference in essentially the water that's being used to inject. Some of it is very brackish, some of it is fresh. So the polymers are different for every application. I will admit there's some projects that are not successful, but we are seeing some that are having some very good success. Does that answer your question, Dick? Yeah. Surface mining, this is the one that tends to be a bit of an outliner. Where in the world do they mine oil? One place, Alberta. Okay? So it's an outlier in terms of a production technology. And that's the one you can go on Google Earth and you can actually take a look at it and see the size of the developments. I can also go on Google Earth and probably find a tailings pond for a uranium mine that has to be monitored for 300 years. Does anyone look at that tailings pond?
Yes.
Okay, there we go. All right, thank you. But there is some very interesting changes that are happening in the extraction process that's changing the nature of the product that we're actually exporting. So traditionally, mined bitumen had to be upgraded. And part of that had to do with the purification process of the crude oil. So the bitumen that was produced from mines with a naphtha type of solvent and secondary recovery did not give you a marketable bitumen. What we're finding happening today is we're using paraffinic solvents and we're actually getting a bitumen that can be shipped to market straight into a refinery. So it's changing the type of feedstock that's going downstream into the marketplace. Heat integration is a huge aspect in our industry, especially with the viscous oils and the larger projects. Every one of those projects has a cogeneration plant on it. Every one has a high degree of heat integration. And again, that's something that is changing the economics of the production of the crude oil, but it's also providing some value in terms of the type of product that goes downstream. So I've given you a sense of some of the variables that are involved in how the technology is changing. Let me give you a bit of a picture of what that means. So traditionally, when people take a look at the oil sands, this map is shown of the oil sands region. And by the way, the geological deposits actually make these 90-degree bends. Okay? That's what I'm saying to you. It doesn't. We've defined it for royalty purposes. But one of the things that we have found out is if we break the oil sands region into subregions, we can actually identify the technology that's used in the region. So what you've heard a lot of is Cold Lake, that part of the oil sands area, Athabasca, and Peace River. And what we've actually done is we've broken Athabasca into three components. Athabasca North, which is north of Fort McMurray. It includes the mines. What we call Athabasca Conklin. I have to ask this question. Have you ever been to Conklin, Alberta? Anyone here? Maurice, you have? You know, they have t-shirts now that, where the hell is Conklin, Alberta? And I'll show you why in a second. Because it's in a very interesting area of development. And then there's Athabasca-Wabasca, which is another area that's using a technology that's different than the other areas. How does that translate? By the way, there's a paper on our website that identifies all this.
Go back one slide, just to that mining area.
Yep.
How big is that compared to Los Angeles?
I don't know, Maurice. How big is that?
It's only 60% of the area of Los Angeles.
Okay, thank you. And if I remember correctly, there's only about 15% of that area that's actually been disturbed. Okay? When you take a look at the mining area in terms of the whole boreal forest, it's like a tenth of the decimal place of the entire boreal forest in Canada. Those are little factoids. But thank you for the answer. I like a person that can answer their own question. Yeah. So here's a graph that we put together last year. The top line is Athabasca. That tends to be mining related with some SAGD. The average growth rate in mining is about 6-7% compounded annually over this period. Will mines grow at this type of rate going forward? Uncertain. There's only one mine coming on at the moment, that is Curl, that is coming on this year. There are some expansions that are proposed, but you have to understand that for many of the mines where they're tied with an upgrader, the fixed production capacity out of that area is tied to the upgrader, not the mine. So when you are looking at developing a mined upgrader integrated facility, your capital is in the upgrader. So what you do is you mine enough ore to keep your upgrader operating. And if nobody is building upgraders for a lot of the mines, then all you're doing is you're bringing new mines in to keep the same level of production. So looking forward, while there is some potential growth, it's probably more what we see as sustaining capital type of investment. This is Cold Lake. Cold Lake is primarily cyclic steam and primary, CHOPS technology. And it's the least, it's the area with the least growth rate. What we are seeing with cyclic steam is that, in fact, the reservoirs, there just isn't the potential growth there. This has been an area that's been in production for 20, 25 years. My father was involved with projects back in the 60s in the area. Husky, this is the upgrader in Husky, it has in Lloydminster. That's that whole area that's served by that particular technology. Then you have Peace River. Really, if you go back, you will find since 1940s that people have been talking about this huge opportunity for development in the Peace River. Not much is happening in Peace River. It's got a little bit of different characteristic in the oil, and it's a little more challenging in a reservoir to produce. I'm getting to the surprise here in a minute, all right? Wabasca, very interesting area. That's polymer floods in the viscous oil region. And it's been an area that's been surprising because people have expected the growth to stop, yet it is the second highest technology growth area in Alberta. And remember, we run research, so we see projects that are on a pilot scale, an applied research scale. So we often see trends happening before they actually enter the commercial marketplace. And what we're finding is polymers in the viscous oils is one area that we're tracking. Because the production in this area is not decreasing, it tends to be growing quite nicely. And it's very highly related to conventional oil fields in the Western Canadian Sedimentary Basin. We're actually seeing an increase in production out of the old basin. A lot of this has to do with enhanced oil recovery techniques, some of them which are polymer related. And then we get to Conklin. This is all SAGD. It's growing at an annual growth rate over this period of about 34-35% per year. We have a little wager going on within the research branch of when Conklin oil production will surpass mining production. And the year we're looking at is 2020. We are hearing estimates and we're seeing capital investments that could grow the production out of Conklin to over 1 million barrels a day by the end of this decade. And why? They figured out the reservoir. So we use the steam oil ratio as a measure of the energy intensity of viscous oil production. And what you see in the top of this slide is the steam oil ratios for cyclic steam. This is the Bakerfield heavy oil type of technology. This is the type of technology that's employed in Cold Lake. And what you're seeing is steam oil ratios in the range of 4 to 5. What you're seeing down below that are steam oil ratios for various SAGD projects. Some are better than others. What you have to take a look at is, number one, you have to take a look at whether the project has a good sense of the geology and whether the size of the project is a pilot project or a commercial project. But the average steam oil ratio for SAGD is less than 3. It's 2.9. And this is a weighted average of actual steam oil ratios, which, by the way, this information is available real time on Alberta Environment's website.
It's a mass ratio?
It's a ratio of the steam and cold water barrels equivalent per barrel of oil produced.
Well, so it's an energy ratio.
Yeah. Okay. What's interesting in this is if you take a look at the top three projects. So the top three projects represent 60% of the oil that's produced in SAGD. And of those, two actually are north of Fort McMurray, and one is not. So Foster Creek is below, Firebag and Mackay River are north of Fort McMurray. Mackay River is a very interesting deposit. It actually is shallower than some of our mines. And they're actually able to produce it with SAGD at a very good steam oil ratio. The rest of the projects down here are all Conklin. This particular project is a very fascinating one, and I'll refer to it several times. Steam oil ratio of 2, We are actually aware they're under 2 on occasion. And what we are seeing is in that whole area around Conklin, which includes the ConocoPhillips, it includes Meg Energy, it includes Jack Fish, and there are other ones that are not on here that are just emerging, Stat Oil's project, Leismer project. They have developed and fine-tuned the technology to be able to make that reservoir respond. But I want to give you a hint of one of the reasons why. Christina Lake, what type of profession do you think the operations manager at Christina Lake is? What type of background do you think he has? You already know the answer. The rest of you, show me a way. If you've got, and Christina Lake now is running, probably getting close to 100,000 barrels a day. It's expanding very quickly. So you've got a guy who runs the operation, is in charge of that operation. It's a $1 billion operation. What do you think his background is?
Business.
Business? Geology? IT? Okay. The guy has a degree out of NATE, Instrumentation and Information Technology. That project, and I'm trying to make sure I don't embellish the number, okay, because I've been around Maurice and I need to recognize that I have to temper my... The number was 20,000 or 28,000 pieces of information either per second or per minute that's collected on that project. And that information is actually diverted to the people that need it. So if it's the field operators, they need information, it goes. If it's the reservoir engineer that needs the information, it goes there. If it's the boiler operator, it goes there. These are extremely data-intensive projects. So if anyone tells you that the oil industry and the gas industry is low-tech, pardon my English, bullshit. And Waterloo is a university that deals a lot with information management. And I'm telling you, these projects are becoming very, very sophisticated. The complexity of the operations are getting to the degree that you need that absolute precision control to get these type of results that you get out of, say, Christina or Surmont. This is not my father's business. My father used to go out to the battery and he'd have the little circle chart that would show him a little bit about the gas-oil ratio, and he'd listen to the well, and you know, he'd listen to the pump jack, and he'd kind of go, okay, this is how we optimize. My father would be blown away if he saw what's happening today. These are like, when you go into the control centers, it's like you're going into a space station. That's what you're looking at is that type of information. I get excited by this, by the way. I'm a strange person for that. This is the trend that's happening in SAGD. So with the top 3 projects, what we're interested in is cumulative SOR. So from a life cycle basis, for example, Steve, they tend to focus on an annual rate, right? What you were really interested in is the cumulative rate, because this is the weighted average throughout the life of the project, and you want to see that dropping over time. But what you can see is here's the steam oil ratios when the projects start. This is the range that these 3 projects are hitting now in steam oil ratio, and you can see the production. So these trend lines are based on actual information. That is a huge change in innovation. And it's only beginning to come out now. If you go back to that production chart, there were no commercial SAGD projects essentially 10 years ago. Foster Creek was just being started. And today what we're seeing is a lot of the pilot projects that have figured out the reservoir are actually putting in modules of 50,000 barrels a day, 30,000 barrels a day. That's a very standard modular size that's going in. We just need a place to sell the oil. This is a chart I put together to say, well, how did we succeed in developing, for example, the one specific innovation? And what this chart looks back is various public policy approaches to resource development. And it looks at essentially 3 tools that are available. fiscal, regulatory, and equity. From a public policy perspective, they'll tell you there's a fourth one. It's called moral suasion. I will do things if they're nice, but I'm really interested in my bottom line. Okay? So to be effective, you actually have to create some sort of business driver or something of that nature. What we've done in this particular chart is we've tried to give a little bit of a sense of what the market conditions were, what the prices were, and the type of policy tool that was used. What's not on here, and had I a product that could have added a line to this chart and revised my PowerPoint presentation with a non-Apple product, I would have added a line. And what would that line have stated here? So currently, are we looking at emerging or developing markets? No. The markets are there. If anything, we're finding restriction to markets. And I'll speak a little bit more about that. Are we looking at price? Well, gee, price of oil, Maurice has already talked about it. We're selling oil at $55 a barrel. Natural gas prices are some of the lowest it's been in years. So the price trend is actually going this way. So what's the policy tool that we're actually going to be looking at? The Premier will be actually speaking a little bit about that tonight. From my perspective, the question I'm asking is, what's the research direction that we can take to address it? And this is an interesting graph, because if you look at the very first line, the one policy tool that was used was research. This was when the province of Alberta was established, and there were two founding pieces of legislation in Alberta. One was the development of the University of Alberta, and the other one was the development of the Alberta Research Council. Both are related because they had, I believe, the same chair, and they also had the same mandate, and that was how to develop the viscous oils in the oil sands region of Alberta. And I point that out because to go forward and keep ourselves competitive, we're going to have to continue on that innovation cycle. It can't stop. It has to continue. This is just a description of the most used policy tools going all the way down. And as I said, moral suasion is not one that tends to be there. We find when we're dealing with the industry, there has to be a bottom line implication or consequence. On a greenhouse gas reduction method, you're aware that Alberta has a carbon price. So people are seeing in their business decision the impact of a carbon price. What we're also seeing in industry is that to reduce their bottom line or increase their bottom line and reduce their costs, they tend to look at reducing energy costs. And the minute they stop or start reducing energy, they actually decrease their greenhouse gas profile, make themselves a more favorable product. So we've got the incentives there to look at that particular aspect. All right, so what else has changed? I gave you an example of what's happening in viscous oils in the oil sands region. Well, tight oil, tight gas, shale oil, shale gas. Has that changed our market? Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, we are looking at policies coming out of the United States, which I'll speak to in a minute. But the advent of the shale oil out of the Bakken is having a different impact on us in terms of exporting oil. The implications of shale gas. Do you people understand now Ontario is getting gas out of the Appalachians, out of the United States? Okay. We're seeing markets regionalize. We're seeing markets able, because of technology, to look at providing the energy they require from local sources, which is a very fascinating change in the energy markets and the dynamics that have occurred. If you go back a century ago, all energy was regional. And then over time, and through the 50s and 60s and 70s, the energy became a commodity and it became cross-regional. And so the markets tended to be very large. What we're finding now is the markets are shrinking. They're getting fragmented. Now, what does this mean in terms of environmental policy? A little example. The United States, 3 years ago, according to the World Bank, was one of the least flaring nations in the world for oil production. This is the most recent data. It's now one of the larger flaring nations in oil production. Do you understand what I'm talking about when I'm talking about flared gas? It's gas that's co-produced with the oil that essentially, if you don't economically recover it, or you don't recover it and put it into a gas system, you flare it off for safety reasons and environmental reasons. The United States has just skyrocketed in flared volumes of gas out of the Bakken. You ask the United States, why don't you conserve that gas? And the answer is?
No pipeline capacity.
We're long on gas.
What?
We're long on gas. Gas is cheap. Why do we need to conserve this gas? So let's flare it. We're not venting it. Vented methane is 25 times more a greenhouse gas contributor than CO2. So, very interesting. What's the driver in the policy in the United States, for example, and other regions as well, Europe and other locations? As technology gives you the opportunity to create your energy commodity internally, you are finding the decisions are more based on economic principles than they are on environmental. This is a classic example. The flaring and venting, and I had a very interesting discussion yesterday with Dick. Dick's working with the World Bank with Maurice on monitoring of methane. We're working with the World Bank, NOAA, on flared gas volumes, trying to get a better understanding. Our contention is conventional oil production with a high degree of flaring is probably one of the worst crude oils to produce in the world on a greenhouse gas basis. Just as an aside, the heavy oils in Alberta, the viscous oils in Alberta and Saskatchewan, don't have very much solution gas with it. So we have a completely different order of magnitude of gas management issue. And because of the size of our projects, we tend not to flare. Okay? So I'm pointing out to you, so number one, markets are getting regional. And when they get regional, what ends up happening is regional economic policy begins to have a much greater play. And we got a market into this. I threw this up as a placeholder on electricity. Electricity is a very interesting commodity because in North America, energy demand is tends to be constant or decreasing, for example, in transportation fuels. This graph is suggesting electricity is doing the same. What it's not showing you, though, is the trend that's happening, what we are seeing statistically, of households using way more electricity than any other commodity. The biggest growth in electricity is in residential uses. So let me give you an example. How many here, maybe not many of us, were around in 1980? And how many electric appliances were in the household? Right? I think the answer is about 2 or 3. Today, apparently, it's close to 20. And they are parasitic power users. Do you think about your PVR? You leave it on because you want to tape something? Geez, you're powering up your computer. Do you turn your computer completely off? You know, what do you do in the household, right? You got a clock on the stove. You got a clock on your microwave. There's so many clocks in the house. You know, and they're all different times, right? The beauty of the electric grid is that it'll actually change the frequency of the power to do clock correction. Because electric clocks actually run based upon the frequency of the power. So if the clock's running too fast, the electric grid will actually decrease the frequency of the power to correct the time. So do you ever change the time in your electric clock? No. The grid does it for you. I just want you to know that. So if you're off grid, you have no idea what time it is. That's what's ending my moral of the story. The comment I want to make here is electricity is also going regional. Electricity has been much more regional to begin with than other energy commodities. But it's even going more regional in terms of supply and demand. So here's the challenges that Alberta has, and Canada. How do we deal with that changing market situation? We're going into a market that's getting fragmented, that's getting regional. Economic policies are in place to deal with economic recovery issues. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with the energy independence? This comment says stagnating electricity markets in North America. Victoria put this down. I disagree with that. I say it's changing electricity markets in North America. We're going away from coal power plants. Ontario is a classic example. Are you aware in Europe that Germany, for example, has banned the use of nuclear power? Do you know what it's going to now for power generation? It's going to coal. I say no more. So here's the issue. This is a graph of reserves that we have in Alberta. And of course, there are reserves, oil reserves off coast in eastern Canada. There are oil reserves in Saskatchewan, BC, and some minor reserves in Manitoba. Huge, huge volume of oil. And it has been cited as being an economic driver in Canada. I don't know how many of you have actually been to northern Alberta. The joke is if you want to fly to St. John's, Newfoundland out of Alberta, you go to Fort McMurray and get a direct flight. Okay? There is a lot of economic impetus and effect of what's happening in northern Alberta on the rest of Canada. But do we have a market to continue? By the way, this amount of reserve would allow us to produce oil, I think, in the range of 300 years at that rate. So there's a huge amount of oil that's sitting in the ground. Natural gas is interesting. Our conventional basins are decreasing. But I can tell you we have pilots underway right now that's looking at multi-zone fracking. So you put down one well, vertical or horizontal, or diagonal, and you actually go through the geology, the different gas plays, and you co-produce out of 3, 4, 5 gas zones at the same time. And you actually frack differently in each zone, so you actually have a balanced flow coming back up through the annulus. That's why some of our gas is still competitive. Even though we have a long way to go, we're finding new ways to improve on the production economics. So here's a forecast of exports. Natural gas. Well, innovation has just taken away our market. Okay?
When are they going to shut down the Trans-Canada pipeline?
Next question. Maybe they'll change it to a different product.
Good point.
Right? Upgraded, non-upgraded bitumen. That's the forecast going out. That assumes we have pipeline capacity, right? And I think many of you are very familiar with what's happening on the discussions on Gateway and with Keystone. And it is a priority of the Alberta government and the government of Canada to try to get us access to other markets. Because essentially, if we don't have access, we're going to have to constrain production. Some people think that may be good. Other people think it may be bad. The market reality is, if we don't have takeaway capacity, why would you keep producing the oil, more and more oil? So what does it mean for Alberta? Well, we're the marginal barrel. We're the marginal cubic foot of gas going into a regional market that's not ours. And that's the difference. So if you look back in the 1960s, the 70s, and the 80s, the 90s, even the early 2000s, we had an interconnected pipeline system in North America. Now, we didn't go to the Gulf Coast. We didn't go to California. We didn't go to the East Coast. But we were extremely well connected into central United States. But as I pointed out to you, those pipelines were built in the 50s and 60s. And from 1973 to 2005, we had surplus takeaway capacity in Canada for our oil. That's not the case now. We're finding ways to debottleneck the system and move our product out, but we're also moving into regional markets. So when we look at the United States market, and Maurice already talked about the discount on the oil, and it's a very interesting discussion because if one can understand to a certain degree a little bit of the play of forces that are happening. The United States is looking at trying to improve its economy. All of a sudden, technology starts developing essentially shale gas and shale oil, so it creates local jobs. The size of that deposit, especially on the oil side, still needs to be determined with more granularity on the gas side. But if I need oil within the country, maybe I should wait and see what I can produce domestically before I start taking oil from outside my region. And by the way, I have a program in place that supports the use of alternatives to oil for transportation purposes. So what's the impact of that policy going to be? And then there's Canada to the north. And they're good people. I like Canadians. I'm Canadian. I think we're great. But from a perspective of down below, a market saying, well, you know, it's kind of nice having them as the marginal barrel. They will top up what we need, but we'll look first internally. And that's my comment about policies are tending to be economic based. They're not necessarily following full life cycle assessments. They're taking a look at the economic side of it. So it does mean something for Alberta and Canada, the whole question of infrastructure, how we develop it, which way we go. Well, what does it mean for technology? A reasonable assumption would be, regardless of whether or not we have the ability to export additional volumes of oil. So we're producing record amounts of oil in Canada today. I think we're the number sixth producer in the world of oil. So we may have restricted access to markets. But if we want to make ourselves in market, we have to improve the economics of producing that barrel of oil. So we've got to look at technologies that actually can be applied to today's deposits. So what we are finding, and I mentioned, is a rebound in the conventional basin. Why? Because the pipelines exist. In many cases, the surface facilities are there, so you don't need the strategic capital investment. It's all sustaining investment. If you go into the viscous oil regions of the oil sands, you've got huge facilities that are there. The challenge is to improve the economics of what you're producing out of that area and perhaps tailoring the product better for what's required downstream. So when we're talking about research efforts, that's a huge area that we look at, and it's efficiency gains. And one of the things that we find in our research pilots is the ability to make that economic benefit is often correlated with the ability to manage a more complex situation. And the more complex situation you have means data management. So one of the things that we are seeing more and more is the improvement in instrumentation and analytical tools, things of that nature, that actually allow these facilities to operate in better high-tech fashion than they are today. I'll give you an example. I'm certain many of you have heard of big data and pattern analytics, right? We have one oil sands company that collected all sorts of data on its production, its bitumen production, and then found a pattern emerging, developed an algorithm and software to change its production train real time, depending upon the ore quality that went in. And the comment is made is that particular facility does not have the best ore body, but it has the best bitumen recovery of any mine. Real time changes. We are now seeing SAGD projects that have real time phase, all three phase mass spectrometers sitting on the wellhead. So they actually are measuring what's coming up the annulus. So this isn't a photograph by NOAA of what flare is happening and trying to judge by the luminosity how much of that is CO2, they're actually measuring off the wellhead casing what's coming up the casing in all phases. Fascinating change. Well, what do you do with that data? You change the nature of your operation. So one of the things that I find quite fascinating with Waterloo, because my sense is you are an institution that does deal with data and management of data. And I'm stating you, there is a phenomenal opportunity that's sitting out there. The comment that Maurice said that talking about the difference in the differential, the $40 differential today, is $75 million a day to the oil industry. And the comment I've made to people before is, can you think of how much you could invest for $1 million in improving an IT process and the benefit it could have right across the industry? I think there's a phenomenal opportunity. It's not so much with the technology, with the physics of putting the steam in the ground. We know that. What we need to know is how to do it better. We need to have an understanding of what's happening underground. The concept, we're dealing a lot with nanotechnologies, and including nanosensors and everything else. And the concept I heard is you illuminate what's happening underground. So you begin to get a sense of where pressure zones are going, where the water zones are going, where the steam is going, and you fine-tune your operation to make it more effective. That's what we're seeing out of an example with Synovus. As I mentioned, the manager of the facility is an IT person, which is quite different, very successful. I get excited by this, but then... One of the things that's fascinating is look at the rate of change of innovation in the last decade in the energy industry. And corresponding with the rate of change is the rate of adaptation. So one of the things that's interesting is new technology is found, whether it's data management or whatever else, there has to be a corresponding adaptation of that technology. And the two have to be in sync. So again, we run research pilots, field pilots, and that's one of the aspects that we see. Why is the government of Alberta actively involved? Well, number one, we believe in open data. Okay? So what we do now is we publish results of our research pilots 2.5 years after they come out. We take no IP position. Why? Because we believe the rate of innovation is actually highly correlated with open information. So Alberta has an environment of trying to put the information into the public domain. We are probably the only state, province, jurisdiction in the world that you can actually go on real time and monitor what's happening with our oil and gas production. Now, why did we do that? We have a fundamental belief that that's going to actually improve our technology. People are going to find solutions. But they need the data to manage. They have to get an understanding of the industry, of what's going on. And this bottom statement, analytical assessment directly impacts operational practices. Absolutely. This is not my father's business. This is my grandchild's business? Not certain. But it's not my father's, I can tell you that. And this is just an example of some future technologies which I couldn't fix up because of my iPad problems, so we won't show the slide, okay? But that's the comment that I'm sort of making to you, and it's becoming very fascinating. Some of the studies that we're starting to do in Alberta is we're trying to get a sense of the pathways of a variety of energy resources. One of the things we're finding is there is a plethora of data that's starting to come out. And so we are doing a study, I was talking with Stephen Young about it this morning, a study called Energy Potential and Metrics. We're actually doing pathway assessments of all the primary energy commodities that are in Alberta and trying to understand what's involved with taking that primary energy and moving it into a finished energy commodity, such as electricity, heat, or a transportation fuel. And trying to get an idea of the metrics, what we should be measuring to find out what the performance is of that pathway. Again, what we're finding is surprisingly huge amounts of data that are now just becoming available. And it's fascinating to see. So I guess the thing I'm sort of leaving you with here And I'm very open to answering any questions on any detailed part of what I provided, but there is a phenomenal opportunity in the energy industry. Even if we don't materially grow how much we produce, we just have to produce what we're doing better. And that also applies on the consumer side, because I'm also aware that this university does a lot of work with smart grids. So consumption, monitoring on the demand side, that's part of the equation as well. Yes?
Chris, I'd like to extend your point further on data that you confine yourself to the production aspects, which is fair, but anywhere up and down that chain as well, if you think about oil drilling, exploration, and geosciences that feed the system, to environmental monitoring, all parts of the chain, the role of data, big data, and real-time provision of data is going to change the way we think about this business, how we manage energy, both the production to the use, and so there's an enormous opportunity way beyond just the production thing that you emphasize all along.
Absolutely. And it's something that we find, we know it's coming. We're seeing the data being generated, and we're trying to get better data. We're finding ways of getting the data to be more representative and accurate. But it is a mental challenge to actually know what will be the result of actually finding the patterns in that data, improving all the different pathways, chains, and it's not just upstream. My business is upstream, right? But it'll go all the way down to the consumer level. It'll go down to people sitting in a vehicle. How many people even think about the fact today that what's making your vehicles more efficient today? Yeah, there's been some improvement in the technology itself, whatever else. A lot of it has to do with electronic and computer control. Do you really know what your vehicle's doing on a day-to-day basis? You know, I had a prior career before I went into the energy business. I was an equipment operator. So I was the guy that run the CAT, run the grader, and everything else. We used to have to actually know our equipment, because there was no metering and monitoring on those big machines. It was all by feel. It was my father's business, right? Hey, there's a knock over here. What would that be for, you know? Nowadays, they are actually using nanotechnology in the oil of the big trucks, that they can censor real time to indicate when it's time to service those 400-ton trucks. They don't do it periodically according to a schedule. They actually use the data from the nanosensoring, and they decide when is the optimal time to service the 400-ton truck. So maybe they push another 200 hours out of the truck before it needs servicing. Huge difference. That's some of the stuff that I find just fascinating that's happening in our business. But absolutely, downstream as well. Yeah.
Chris, thank you very much for this discussion. I wanted to come back a little bit to Maurice's point about the differential, but take it to the technical side.
Sure.
So the quote in the Globe is that Canadian heavy oil takes more energy and therefore more cost to process into fuels like gasoline or diesel. And that's why it's sold for cheaper. That's quoted in the Globe 2 days ago. The oil that goes from Alberta through that pipeline and from Hardisty comes out the other end in Texas, is it physically different? And given the range of technologies, are we achieving an oil that is more or less satisfactory to the refiner at the other end, that their cost won't be greater?
Let me give you
a whole range of production there.
Very, very good question. Let me answer the question in generalities. Viscous oil, the heavier the oil, there's a tendency for it to require more energy to process into gasoline and diesel. So historically, heavy oils or viscous oils have sold at a discount to light oils. That discount allows the refiner to put the capital into place to actually process the heavy ends of the barrel. So, what is it reasonable to expect a heavy oil to get the same premium as a light oil in the marketplace? The answer is no. And it's not been there historically. There's always been a discount. It's the size of the discount. So when it used to be $15 a barrel discount, that was the benchmark, I think, Maurice, that we used to use in saying, well, geez, upgrading may be viable. Taking the heavy crude, making it into an interim feedstock, a synthetic light crude oil to go into a refinery. Now we're looking at the differential being $40.
But the product hasn't changed?
No.
But then the price is driven by demand?
Correct.
That's, and they're saying that they don't want that material as much as they did 5 or 10 years ago.
And where's the change been in the marketplace? Tight oil. Tight oil is between us and our marketplace.
So the balance at the refinery, the buyer at the refinery says, that heavy oil we used to need this much, and now we need this portion.
They will always need a certain amount of heavy oil, because there's certain products that you get out of a heavy oil that you don't get out of a light oil. And the refineries for optimization will blend feedstock coming in. The change that's happened in the marketplace is you've got a new supply of crude sitting right on the pipeline route of where our traditional market has been. So if I'm the US president, and I want to say I want to balance my supply and demand in the United States, and I got oil being produced in the United States versus outside the United States, where would I take the oil from first?
I suppose what I struggle with is by pushing more oil down a pipeline and not changing the quality of the product at the other end, I'm actually going to reduce the price.
Yep.
Increase that differential.
There's a tendency.
The only way that they're going to buy more is if I make it cheaper.
Correct, or the returns are there. Now recognize the price could change if the supply, if there wasn't the surplus capacity. So the challenge that we're always faced with is looking at a short-term market aberration versus where the long-term trend would go. And so there is a glut of tight oil right now, but we are seeing some projections that there is a flush of oil in the first 3 years, and then it tapers off. So the reality is, what will be the market balance in 3-4 years? My comment is, regardless, we have to be more efficient in the way we produce oil. So if we're only getting $55, $60 a barrel, let's make sure that we can produce it at sub 50, 55 and get the return that we want.
Absolutely. So reduce our costs.
Yep.
Because we don't control the price.
That's right.
And I apologize. Thank you very much. I got to run to it.
Excellent. Please.
Thank you.
Just wondering, why don't we put more refineries directly in the oil sands areas, like where we produce the oil? You know, why not have more refineries of those end products? There seems to be a lot of shipping out of diluted bitumen and viscous oils and all this through pipelines, and then trying to get to the pipelines, and apparently dill bit is more corrosive because you have to.
No, it's not more corrosive. There's a lot of studies that.
Why not do more production? Put a big refinery there right in the oil sands and ship out finished diesel fuels, finished gasoline.
It is something that's being looked at. But the challenge you're looking at is you're competing in a marketplace that has no growth for diesel and gasoline. So you are now competing greenfield versus brownfield. And so the challenge you have is whether you would have to push somebody out of the marketplace. Can you do it by building a refinery in Alberta or in Ontario or whatever else? Possibly. And there are niche opportunities. We have the Northwest Refining and Upgrader going into Edmonton now because it has found a market opportunity. But the market will change. But fundamentally, the challenge we've got is you've got a steady demand for a product actually decreasing, and you've already got capital invested. So when you do the business driver of this, you've got to look and say, can I invest capital in a new project and end up not being the marginal barrel of gasoline and diesel on the market? Because if I'm the marginal barrel on the market, I'm the one that gets kicked out, brought back in, kicked out, and brought back in. And there are people looking at that economic opportunity. But part of the challenge we have is that particular issue. There's also an issue of contamination. When you move down a product line, and by the way, every state has a little bit of a different fuel quality, okay? So if we made a gasoline or diesel in Alberta and we shipped it to California, it may meet California standards. Actually, California is the highest standard. If we made it for Washington State, it couldn't be used in California. And so one of the things that we find, even with biofuels, you tend to find the final finishing of the product to meet the specifications happens where the consumer is, not upstream. Because it isn't a total same product. Okay? If you put a biofuel, you put ethanol in a refinery in Edmonton, and you put it in pipe all the way down to Chicago, the ethanol has an affinity to water. By the time it got to Chicago, you would have to reprocess the fuel. So you're adding a cost. So there's those type of issues that are involved with this. I don't think people understand the complexity that's in the refining business. Actually, I know they don't. Because you've always, it's like electricity. You go to the wall, you flick the switch, you got power. You go to the gas station, you got gas, right, Danny? There's no differentiation. I've got gas. Do I really know how that gas is produced or the diesel? Do I understand all the process pathways it went through? No. You know, and do you really care? Maybe in some cases you should.
But that ignorance doesn't keep you from having a strong opinion.
Well, exactly. So does that help answer your question?
That's interesting.
Well, yeah. Let me rephrase it a little bit. All across the east coast of China, they have all the refining capacity needed to meet Chinese demand. So we say, okay, we're going to ship bitumen to Prince Rupert, and then we're going to turn it into gasoline and diesel fuel, and the Chinese will buy it. No. They'll go and get crude oil from Iraq, Indonesia, to keep their upgraded refinery.
There's also
on the east coast of China.
So think about something else. So as a refinery has a byproduct, sulfur. Oh, I need sulfur for fertilizer. So does China want a refined product, or does it want the base feedstock? I need to build infrastructure. I need to build roads. What's a major component in road building? Surfaces. Asphaltenes, the heavy end of a barrel. The best asphalt in the world has often been said comes out of the Lloydminster area, the heavy oil area in Canada. So if I'm building highways in China, maybe I want that bottom of the barrel to give me the asphaltenes to make the asphalt so I can put surfaces on the new roads that I'm just building like crazy. So do I want a finished barrel of product? In some cases, perhaps yes. But in some cases, I may want to have the whole barrel of feedstock because I have the opportunity of actually getting a whole bunch of co-products out of it. It's not simple.
Across the North Atlantic right now, we've got millions of barrels that go back and forth between Europe and the East Coast of the United States because America runs on gasoline. Europe runs on diesel. But a barrel of oil doesn't, you just can't turn the dial and say 100% gasoline. Sorry, the refining, you refine a range of products. You can tweak it, but you're going to produce some diesel and some jet, not just gasoline. So the Americans export that diesel to Europe. And the Europeans, from Rotterdam and the other big refinery, they export gasoline to the United States to balance the markets on both sides of the
line. There's also the refinery configuration in Europe creates a lot of fuel oil, which they can't process, which they actually move to the U.S. Gulf Coast, and it gets processed into distillate, into diesel, and sent back to Europe. The market is very dynamic. That's why it's difficult to stay. But from a, so that's the manufacturing side. And somebody here was talking about the manufacturing aspect that's involved in the industry. From the crude supply, it's a little different. Crude is much more regional. The manufacturing tends to still have a more broader market aspect, or if I may say, market intrusion, market effect, than the actual crude supply that's going in. Danny.
Let's talk big data and visibility. I mean, I'm very impressed with what the great upstream and even the refinery are. But to me, the gorilla in the group is visibility.
Yep.
We feed it in, disappears into the pump. We don't have any sensory OBD data except for occasional samples. We could be tapping into the OBD2 here. We could be tapping into the customer.
And so, you know, I mean, the areas, and that's something I totally agree. On the consumer side, Alberta doesn't have many consumers, okay? You know, we're not very densely populated. But there is that aspect. Our focus is on the upstream side of the business. That's where we focus. That's where our knowledge is. That's where we put our focus. That's where our natural advantage is. Do we recognize the downstream aspect? Do you remember that policy chart I put up? We ran efficiency charts in 1980, or efficiency programs, 1970s, 1980s, and we found consumers were not responding. So Alberta began to deregulate markets. So it deregulated oil, it deregulated gas, and it deregulated electricity. Why? Because the thing that we found is what makes consumers move is price. All right, so, and that still is a bit of a fundamental tenet that we have. Price signal will get people to change behavior, both from a supply side and on the consumer side.